The Gnome sort algorithm is a sorting algorithm that swaps adjacent elements if they're out of order, like bubble sort or cocktail sort. But instead of doing whole passes in one direction, it goes left if it swapped and right if it didn't. I'm going to write the code for Gnome sort and go through how it works step by step. I'll also show you what happens in different cases, like if it's already sorted, almost sorted, or reversed. So here we're defining a procedure called sort, which takes an array of numbers called result, as well as the index of the beginning and the end of the range that we want to sort. We're going to be looking at adjacent pairs of elements. I'm going to create a variable called I to represent the left-hand side of the adjacent pair, and I plus 1 will be the index of the right-hand side of the adjacent pair. We're going to loop until I plus 1 goes off the right-hand side of the range that we're sorting. Then we're going to look at the adjacent pair, and if the one on the left is greater than the one on the right, we're going to swap them. So the rule for Gnome sort is that if you swap, you go left. And then if you don't swap, you go right. So if we take a look at what that does, we're going to look at the first adjacent pair on the left, which is a 5 and a 4. And they're in the wrong order, so we're going to swap them and go left. And then we're going to crash because we've gone off the left-hand side. So when I said if you swap, go left, don't go left if you're already on the left-hand side. So you go left if you're not already on the left-hand side of the range that you want to sort. And that right there is the Gnome sort algorithm. That's all there is to it. To give you a rough idea of how it works, I'm going to start by running it on a larger list. So if you watch it running for a while, you'll see that a sorted run is building up on the left-hand side. And the little red gnome is ferrying elements from the right and moving them into position on the left, and then going back to pick up another element. And then it ferries the next one into place, and then it goes to pick up the next one, and then it puts that one into place, and then it goes to pick up the next one. And it just keeps going back and forth like that. So it essentially works like insertion sort, where we have an unsorted list on the right and a sorted list on the left. And we take each element from the unsorted list on the right and insert it into the sorted list on the left. But this is doing it with a little gnome moving backwards and forwards. And something else I want you to notice, and I've highlighted it in green to make it clear, is that at all times, everything to the left of the gnome is already sorted. So the gnome can't proceed further to the right until everything to the left of it is a sorted run, which means that if it makes it all the way to the right-hand side, then the entire list must be sorted. Okay, now I'll go through the smaller list step by step. So we start with the first two elements, the 5 and the 4, and they're in the wrong order, so we swap them. And we would go left, but we're already as far as we can go to the left, so we're going to stay where we are And then we're going to look at the same two elements again and see that this time they're in the right order, so we don't swap them and go right. Now, I could leave that as it is, but I also could optimize it so I don't do two comparisons on the 5 and the 4. So I'll just quickly show you that. So if we swap, we go left. But if we're already on the left, we can go right. And that should work, but I'm going to quickly refactor that by notting the if condition and swapping the branches. And that should do the same thing, but it's a little bit easier to read. So let's go through it step by step. We're looking at the first two elements, the 5 and the 4. They're in the wrong order, so we swap them. But this time, we're going to go right. The 5 and the 7 are in the right order, so we leave them alone and go right. And then the 7 and the 1 are in the wrong order. So we're going to swap them and go left. So if I just go back a second, you'll see that the 4, 5, 7 has formed a run. And we've moved right till we've got to the end of this run where there's a 1. So what it's going to try and do is insert the 1 into the run on the left. So the question is, exactly how is it going to do that? And so we'll go through it step by step. So notice that the 1 is on the right-hand side of the pair of numbers that we're looking at. And the 7 and the 1 are in the wrong order, so we're going to swap them, which puts the 1 on the left-hand side of the two numbers we're looking at. And then, because we swapped, we go to the left. And that means that that 1 is now on the right-hand side of the pair of numbers that we're looking at. So when we do our comparison, the 1 has started off on the right. They're in the wrong order, so we swap. The 1 is then on the left. And then because we swapped, we move to the left, which means the 1 is now on the right. And again, because they're in the wrong order, we swap. And we would go left, but we've already made it as far to the left as we can go. And it just so happens that is exactly where the 1 needs to go. It's the lowest number, so it happens to be lower than everything else. And so it's that that ends the movement to the left. So we're now going to start going right. And when we're moving across a run of things that are in order, we keep going to the right, until we get to something that's out of order. And that's another element that we need to insert into the run on the left. So we want to insert the 6 into the run on the left. So what happens? Well, it's on the right-hand side. The 7 and the 6 are in the wrong order, so we swap them. And then the 6 is on the left-hand side. And then we move left, which puts the 6 on the right-hand side. Now, here we compare them, and they're in the right order. We know the 6 has reached its destination within the run because the element to the left of it is smaller than it. So it finds that they're in order, so we don't swap and move right. And then we keep going right until we get to something that's out of order, and we get this 3. And so this 3 needs to be inserted, and it's going to go by swapping. And then we move left. We swap, and we move left. And we swap, and we move left. We swap, and we move left. And we swap, and we move left. But then we find that this pair, the 1 and the 3, is in order because the 3 is now in its correct position. So we don't swap and we move right. And we keep going right till we get to the 2. And then we swap left, swap left, swap left, all the way until the two is in position, and when we go left again, but then we find something that's in order, so we keep going right. And once we get to the right-hand side of the range, then we know the list must be sorted because everything to the left of the gnome is always a sorted run. So let's take a look at what happens if I use the gnome sort algorithm to sort an already sorted list. The gnome just moves from left to right as quickly as possible. It compares two elements, sees that they're already in order, doesn't swap them, moves right. Compares the next two, sees that they're in order, doesn't swap them, moves right. So move right, all the way from the beginning to the end. So it doesn't do any swaps, and you'll notice the number of comparisons that it does is the minimum number of comparisons that you would need to determine that the list is already sorted. So just like an optimized bubble sort or cocktail sort, the already sorted case is completely optimal. Let's take a look at that large shuffled list again, but I'll run it a bit faster. Notice how far the gnome needs to move to insert each element. Well, sometimes it's got a long way to go, and sometimes it doesn't have to go very far. Like, it's completely random where it is within the run that the element needs to be inserted. So sometimes it's a small element and it's got to go all the way to the left to take it to where it needs to be. And sometimes it's quite a large element and it doesn't have to go very far to get to where it needs to be. So when it's randomly shuffled, the distance that the gnome travels, which affects the time it takes, is quite random. So what happens in the reverse case? See, in this case, every journey that the gnome takes is the maximum possible distance, because every new element that it has to insert always goes as far as it possibly can to the left, which means the gnome has to travel the absolute maximum distance that it possibly could have to travel in the reverse case, which makes the reverse case a worst case for gnome sort. In fact, because it's kind of getting slower as it goes, I am going to have to speed this up. And as it gets slower and slower, as the gnome has further and further to travel to insert each element, I'm going to take this opportunity to remind you that you can show your appreciation by pressing the like button. So what do you think will happen if it's almost sorted? Essentially what happens is that in the almost sorted case, the gnome just doesn't have to travel very far to insert each element, which means it's actually very fast. Now I'm going to show you what happens if I hold on the swap instruction. So we're only seeing what happens at the points where we're on this particular instruction. And you might notice it's doing the same swaps that insertion sort would do if you were doing insertion sort with swaps. If I optimize the gnome sort algorithm so that instead of moving step by step to the right over the already sorted elements, it just remembered where the end of the run was and jumped back there after it inserted each element, you'd get an algorithm that you could think of as an optimized version of gnome sort, Or you could think of it as insertion sort, but using swaps. And if you want to know more, I suggest you watch my insertion sort video, which you can also find on a playlist with all of my other sorting algorithm videos.